You are listening to the Place We Find Ourselves podcast. I'm Adam Young, and I'm honored today to be joined by Aundi Kolber. Aundi, welcome to the podcast.
Oh, thanks so much for having me, Adam.
Aundi is a fellow therapist, not far from me, also in Colorado, and she's also the author of a great book called Try Softer, which I think is such a disarming title. And we're going to talk primarily about your book, Aundi, but before we do, since this podcast is about the intersection of trauma and story, can you share a little bit about how did you come to engage your own story? What started you down that path?
Yeah, for me, yeah, this is very, very much intertwined with the fact that part of my story is that I am a survivor of complex trauma from my childhood. In addition to being a trauma therapist, you know, that has been sort of my way in to much of this work. Like the passion I think that I have for it first started because I didn't have a lot of language. I didn't have a lot of direction for what I had experienced in my childhood. And even when I became a therapist, you know, I got my master's and I even became licensed. And as you know, like complex trauma is still not in the DSM. I had this sense like things weren't fine in my childhood. I knew that, you know, but I always felt like I didn't have permission to think of myself as a survivor of trauma, in part because on the outside, I looked pretty put together. I was able to do some things that looked impressive on the outside. And because of that, I always, in turn, minimized my own pain. Like, because I was able to do X, Y, and Z, therefore I'm fine. And so it really took, I mean, I think of those now as like, those were my coping skills. That's how I white knuckled. That's how I survived. That's how it was like, hey, if I can't get my needs met by actually being seen, by actually being known, by actually being attuned to, like at least I could be impressive. And so that was a way that I came to get some of, in some form, those needs met. It was really when I became a mom. And it was like white knuckling, it wasn't that helpful as a mom because I couldn't white knuckle my daughter into sleeping. I couldn't push or will myself into being attuned. And it was like that was the thing that took it all the way down to the center. And I was like, wow. There is so much more pain here than I had ever realized.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's a very unsettling realization that I think a lot of people with trauma have as adults. It's the realization, oh my gosh, I might have a lot more pain than I even thought I had.
It was quite unsettling. And then, you know, I had some parts who were then started to criticize me for like, you know, what do you think you're doing? You can't be weak. Who do you think you are? We got stuff to do. You have an, you know, in a sense, like almost like an image to project. And at this point I've been a therapist for about 15 years. And I mean, I was into being a therapist. Like something can be right in front of your face. And I remember I had a therapist and she was lovely. But one day I was talking about a family member who had complex trauma. And my therapist said, oh, Aundi, you do too. And I was like, I do. But in my family of origin, I was always the strong, like Aundi's fine. Oh, she's fine. Like Aundi can do it. Aundi can handle it. When I was in pain, it was like that made me work harder to find some other way to get it, that need met in some way. All that to say, it has really been a journey. I would say especially the last 11, 12 years where I've really been able to sink in, I would say deeper, you know, because I was doing some work and I'm grateful for that. I mean, I've been doing work for a long time, but I don't think my body was ready to hear the level of trauma that I experienced. Like I wasn't yet ready to acknowledge how much pain I had. I speak about it like it is an honor to get to reparent and to befriend and love the parts of myself that didn't get what they need. Both in my own journey and often in my clients' journeys, I see how often people's pain, and not just pain, but like what it's required, the cost to survive. And I think when we take the time and we say, oh, I honor that.
Yes.
Like, I see you. You are doing everything. You have done everything possible just to still exist. And that is not nothing.
Right.
That is sacred. And so that's how that, you know, some of the tears, that's, it's like those parts of myself just feel so honored.
Yes.
Because they know that I believe that. Like, I am like, you're not a burden. You didn't deserve what happened to you. What an honor to be able to participate in the repair.
Yes. That's so well said. I want to start with some of your words from your book that are very relevant to what you're talking about now, and just quote a sentence from the introduction. This is what you write. You say, I didn't know how to listen to my own needs or the rhythms of my body. Consequently, when stressful times arose, I dealt with them the only way I knew how, by just trying to push through them, shaming myself in the process. So, you know, when I read that, I thought most of us, especially those of us with a history of trauma, we deal with stress by trying harder, by pushing through, pressing on. People with a history of trauma tend to develop like an action tendency to push through, press on, power up when the going gets tough, especially when we get dysregulated, anxious, fearful. And your book, Try Softer, is inviting us really to an alternative way of being in the world, particularly an alternative way of responding to our own bodies when we are stressed. So let's just talk about the title for a minute. What are you wanting for us by inviting us readers to try softer?
So try softer has come to mean and represent for me a framework. And what that framework, probably the most concise way that I would say it is the practice of learning to pay compassionate attention to our experiences.
Say that again.
Yeah. So really, Try Softer is a framework. I think of it as a framework. And in that framework, one of the primary goals is to learn how to pay compassionate attention to our experiences.
Yes.
And I see that phrase, that idea, that main almost mechanism of compassionate attention as being the thing that allows so many other things. And so this compassionate attention it's very related to our body, our ability, like, to actually physically tolerate on a neurobiological level, witnessing ourselves.
Say, what do you mean by witnessing ourselves, Aundi?
So in Try Softer, in the book, I really really lean heavily on Dan Siegel's work. I'm super grateful for him. And one of the things that he talks about is that we can observe ourselves when we can think about thinking. So when we witness ourselves, that's a little bit of what I'm saying. Like, I can observe that I have an emotion.
Yes.
I can observe, like, when you said that to me, I am noticing some tension in my stomach. And so this practice of compassion and of attention, it's sort of what allows us then to do so many other things. And so, you know, tying this to someone who has a history of trauma, oftentimes, like in our, you know, in our childhood, really the skills, the platform of safety in our body that is supposed to be developed with our caregivers is where we can, over time, we build up to the ability to think about thinking and to observe ourselves. And then this allows us to have the ability to be like, oh, when Fred said that to me, and I'm noticing anger rise up in my chest, as I observe that, now I can work with that anger.
Yes. But what you're saying, Aundi, is that, and you even use this language later in the book, the key that unlocks trying softer is, that's your phrase later in the book, is this ability to attune to what you call the internal workings of our bodies, of what's happening inside of us. Mm-hmm. And what I'm hearing you say is that that's the starting point, awareness of what I am subjectively experiencing as I interact with people, as I go about my day, that's the starting point of trying softer.
Absolutely. And I think this is a key, because I love the phrase in and of itself, try softer. Like I talk about in the book, one of my supervisors said this to me, and it honestly blew my mind because I was trying so hard. But the reason why I wanted to unpack it in such a big framework is that sometimes for trauma survivors, our initial response might be to push and to do all those things. But when our body perceives that's no longer helpful is when we begin to go down into dissociation or various forms of like depression or a collapse. And so now then we don't want to try softer in the technical sense, but that compassionate attention allows us to say, okay, what do I need?
Which is such an important question. Okay, what do I need? And that is a question that those of us with trauma rarely ask.
Yes.
Part of what you're inviting us to in this book is to ask that question. What do I need?
And I do think this work is helpful for anyone, even if they don't have an extensive history of trauma. Like, I think this is just in our culture, we don't teach these things very well. Some folks have a little bit better of an intuitive jumping off point because of how they were parented. So I think that's true. But with this entire work of Try Softer, it really is the work of wanting to give people like this framework of saying like, your internal experience matters.
Yes.
How you are with yourself matters. How we are with ourselves in pain matters. The information our body is giving us, it really matters. It's the map. Your body's giving you a map. This is, you know, something I talk about a good amount in Try Softer as well, is this concept of the window of tolerance. Mm-hmm. In order to pay that compassionate attention, we have to be within at least 1 foot in the window of tolerance. And what I mean by that is just, it's a range of arousal in which we can feel our feelings or have an experience and our body perceives that there's still some level of safety. Mm-hmm. But once we exceed that limit, we would go into that fight or flight, or we would maybe go down into a dissociation or a fawn. Once we go out of our window, our prefrontal cortex is no longer online.
And when it's not online, what ability do we lose?
Yeah, I mean, we lose all of our executive functioning. We lose our rational thought. We lose the ability to be curious and to learn.
And we can't pay compassionate attention.
That's right. Yes.
We can't do that first step.
In all the work that I do, I always am keeping this in mind, this window of tolerance. Because for me, to be totally frank, as a survivor of trauma, this teaching has changed my life. When I began to know in my own body, okay, I'm going out. Okay, there I am. I'm right at the threshold. You know, like when I can begin to notice that with compassionate attention, now I've got more choice. Because that, this is that threshold is where we still have a choice. And we can, let's say if we're going up into that sympathetic nervous system, we can downregulate. Or if we're noticing, oh, I've got dread. I'm starting to feel spacey. I might even feel a little sick. Like, oh, that might be, you know, my dorsal vagal. Like I'm beginning to feel like that's some dissociative qualities coming up. Oh, I need to gently upregulate. And I can do that because I'm noticing.
Yes. You're noticing your inner experience and it's mattering to you. In other words, you're being attuned to your own self, your own body. And what we know is that so much of developmental trauma is about the lack of attunement from mom and or dad to our emotional states as children. And trying softer begins with you attuning to your insides.
Yes.
That is very healing for the brain.
Yeah, I mean, it really is. For me, this work is very much connected to working towards earned secure attachment, experiencing that in ourselves as like, that we can be a safe place to ourselves. You know, this is why I have chapters on attachment, because you just can't separate how much these things are intertwined. And though I don't always only work on the attachment piece, this is all attachment based because it's all relational. This is always about not feeling safe in connection with people, or the abandonment, or not, you know, feeling like I have to avoid because it feels too big, or literally for folks who might connect with a disorganized attachment, the terror with even the possibility of connection and carrying that around in our body. Holy moly. That's such a high cost. And so these little moments of safety, these tiny, teeny, tiny over time, over decades. And I think earlier when I got some tears in my eyes, that's the work.
Yes.
Those parts of myself who have felt so unsafe in various settings and at times with my caregivers and different experiences of trauma, it's like they can come and they're like, do you have me? And I'm like, yeah, I got you.
So I want to read the sentence I read already one more time, because I want to ask you about the very end of it. What you wrote is, when stressful times arose, I dealt with them the only way I knew how, by just trying to push through them, shaming myself in the process. Now, can you say more about shaming myself in the process? What did you feel shame about when you tried to push through stressful, anxious times?
That's a great question. Nobody's actually ever asked me that question in the last couple of years. And so I think that's a great question. It's the conflict, the internal conflict of some part of myself is like, okay, like we just gotta figure this out. You just gotta go a little harder. And then I think of it like the little voice of like, oh, but I'm so tired. Like, oh, but can we not? Oh, but more of this? And the shame is a response to that. The shame is like, oh, you just get in the corner and you shut up. You think you're going to survive this if we don't do this? You think you're going to get what you need? Like, you think people are going to be there for you? You think anybody else is going to show up? I really think of it as like the secondary experience of the part of me who's like protesting the pushing.
Yes. And there's this other part of you that is turning on her.
Yes.
And saying, for two decades, this has worked. And you did it. You powered through. You figured it out. you dealt with whatever was coming at you. And now that you're a mother and you can't mother well, I mean, you hear the tone of accusation, the shaming that you're not, quote unquote, strong enough.
Ooh.
All of a sudden.
Yes. For so long, my identity and really what people in the world knew me as was this go-getter, tenacious. And so it really was like, you want to stop this now? Like, what else are you going to do? You don't have any other gigs here.
Right. I mean, there's a crucible in that moment because you are coming face to face with a vow, a commitment that you made as a very little girl to survive what you were having to endure. And it worked, but it didn't work, but it did work until you were a mother of a daughter that was not going to have it.
I mean, truly, my daughter's first year of life, it was a crucible. I mean, it really was. It really did bring me to this place of just deep vulnerability, deep grief. And there was a lot of shame. There was a lot of shame. And this is why this framework of TriSofter for me has been essential. Because even with the shame, I've had to take that shame and be like, listen, baby, I know you're trying to help me. I get it. I get that you have seen me survive for this long, but listen, it's not working anymore. And as that's happened, that shame voice has softened. And so it's like I've had to create this, I think, you know, and it's very much attachment language, but it's like this safe, soft place. And I'm like, come here. I got you. Like, I know this is hard. I know this is painful. I know this is scary. And what has been needed for me to do that is, you know, I have a husband who is incredibly supportive and attuned, not perfect, but like that has been essential so that I've had to have some great therapy. I've had to do a lot of really finding spaces where I felt safe, so that I could then bring that safety in.
Let's go to chapter one. We were in the introduction. Now we're in chapter one, and we're not going to do all the chapters, but here's a brilliant and succinct explanation that you offer of why I often emphasize the importance of engaging one's own developmental story. Here's how you put it. You say, I don't consider stories to be abstract concepts, but instead the neurobiological framework through which we experience life. Simply put, stories, or the compilation of events, emotions, sensations, ideas, and relationships we've experienced, are held in our minds and bodies, and they affect how we see the world. I love that sentence. There's a lot in it. So let's just break it down into bullets. Here's what you're saying. Number one, you're saying your personal story in your family of origin, it's not just a concept. It is written in the neurobiology of your brain. And we know this is true now. Number two, you're saying your personal story refers to the events, emotions, sensations, ideas, and relationships that you've experienced. And third, you're saying that those events, emotions, and relationships are inscribed in your mind and body, and they affect how you see the world. So what do you mean when you say that our story is held in our minds and bodies?
Yeah. All of those things that we've described, like the events, emotions, sensations, ideas, relationships, particularly, but not only, but particularly in, you know, our childhood. That is one of the primary catalysts of what is shaping our brain, our body, our nervous system.
Yes.
It's like we're not just, we don't come out of the factory like, here's your, you know, deep, 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 here I am, like the same as this other person. We have these unique, all of these histories that are unique to us. And what that means is that on in a really physical, practical way, you know, the care we received, the interactions we had, the moments we got to savor joy, the times we were attuned to, the times that there were ruptures, but then they were repaired. All of that is shaping the actual physical body that we have.
Right. It's affecting the connection of one neuron to another neuron. And you've got billions of them. But what you're saying, Aundi, and we know this from neuroscience, is that our relational, especially relational experiences, change the neuronal connections in our brain. And that in turn becomes the filter for how we experience our life the rest of today.
Yes. If you've grown up in a home where, like, in a really practical way, you didn't feel safe. And I use safety very broadly, meaning it wasn't safe to be yourself. It wasn't safe to feel your feelings. It wasn't safe to express your needs. It wasn't safe to be seen. All of those, safety in a very broad sense. When our brain has to prioritize danger and threat, there can be significant alterations to our brain. And that means, you know, as humans, we already have a predisposition to scanning, like, for danger, for, like, seeing things like, oh, someone criticized me. So even though I got one criticism and 10 compliments, the criticism, that's what I'm noticing, you know? Some of that is normal for every human. But if you have grown up in homes, right? So depending on your experience, that might look a little different. But whatever the danger was, whatever the threat was, turn that volume up. And if that hasn't been repaired, if that's not being tended to, that's what we're carrying with us. And we know that what we pay attention to shapes our brain. That means that if you're continually on that lookout, that's still true. If it's still like, who doesn't like me? Who doesn't love me? What's coming next? What's the danger? But we're missing. Oh, look at that sunset. I mean, look at the way my kids look at me. Look at this meaningful work I get to do. We are predisposed to miss that. And so partly, I think this connects to the story piece, because that's the continued story, that when that goes unresolved, when that goes untended to, when that previous developmental story is not being tended to, it's deeply influencing the story we're writing right now.
Yes. You're teary again. What's moving you?
Partly, I'm a very passionate person, but also I just think these things are really important.
Mm-hmm. And they're, my guess is they have been earned at such a high cost for you.
They really have. I think for me, allowing myself to feel some emotion is actually a form of integration. You know, we exist in a world in which these things are not honored or not, and they're not named. And most people's costs is not recognized, both with others and in themselves.
Yes.
The cost of not seeing the goodness is so high. And that's worthy of grief.
It's so clear to me that you have arrived at a new level of tenderness for your own heart, for what you suffer when you get dysregulated now with your daughter. Like, you've arrived at a new level of tenderness and compassion and kindness for Aundi.
Yes.
And trying softer is what got you there.
Yes. Very much. Very much. And, like, I really see this as stewarding the way God sees me. Mm-hmm. Like, it's already there. It's like, this is what's already true. And then I get to steward that. It's like I get to partake. I get to participate and be like, let me, to all the parts of myself that have been wounded, I get to gather that and be like, ooh, let me show you. You're so loved. Let's partake of this together. Like, this goodness. It's almost, this is not quite the right word, but it's almost rebellious.
It's defiant.
It's defiant.
One more sentence from your book. You write that learning how to be with our stories in our bodies without becoming overwhelmed by or numbing our past experiences is the way we will learn how to actually handle and move through the grief and anxiety that come up. So in that sentence, you're claiming that being with our stories, being with, is part of the way to digest and metabolize the grief and anxiety that we all feel. What do you mean by being with our stories?
I think this is a super key component to this work. And it builds on some of the other things we've talked about. Again, it's one, we have to be in our window of tolerance, at least partially, because otherwise we're really coming from that survival brain. And from the survival brain, we can't observe. So we're really blended in when we're in that survival brain. Like we can't see with any noticing. There's no space. There's no reflection. There's only reaction. So the window of tolerance, the compassionate attention, as we have that compassionate attention, I think of it almost like let's say there's an area of our story, like my story or someone's story that got activated. Someone says something to them and they're like, oh, wow. like I'm feeling it in my throat. I feel like I can't speak up for myself. When I use that language of be with, what I mean is it's like oftentimes I think of my adult self like this, you know, this compassionate self who comes to join whatever part of my story, whatever age. And so I think that being able to externalize that a little bit by like seeing that compassionate self with, you know, maybe it's like a teenage self who felt like they didn't get to speak up. I really think of that like this is repair. Being with is oftentimes if you experienced those repairs as a kiddo, it's easier to intuitively know how to repair in ourselves, but also to ask for help repairing. Like, hey, to my good friend, like this happened, like I'm feeling like I need support. Could you just sit with me?
Right. And that's such a, and sorry to interrupt you, but that is such a foreign sentence to so many people with trauma. Hey, I need support. Could you sit with me or help me? I mean, my guess, Aundi, is that you weren't apt to say that as a 25-year-old woman.
I absolutely wasn't. I mean, truly, I've come to understand the level to which vulnerability felt like such a threat to my body, like an absolute, like terrifying threat to be weak. And I put that in quotes because that's not weak.
But that's how it would have felt to you as a younger woman. It would have, to ask for help would have felt like weakness.
Yes. Because even for someone to notice that I wasn't okay felt like a threat. Sometimes we have to titrate. We have to go little by little. Like if something is a severe, like if your body, if it feels terrifying to do something like that, it's not going to be like flipping a switch and being like, okay, never mind. That's not terrifying anymore. We have to go at the pace of our bodies. So that, you know, whether you think of it like your protectors or your window of tolerance, we're building just little by little the safety to say, hey, you know, for me, it was like first with my husband, like I can be seen in my vulnerability and this is okay. It's safe to be here, you know?
Right. And disaster is not going to happen.
Yeah. The reality is as a kiddo, it wasn't safe for me to have needs.
Right.
And I think this is important for trauma survivors to hear. Your body is reacting that way for a reason. Your body is wise. Your body's like, oh, we've been down this road before.
It's working properly. We could say it like that. Your nervous system is working properly by distrusting your husband initially. That's what you're saying. And your nervous system in that sense has to be blessed before it can experience healing.
Yeah, that really sacred space of really being honored for where I was, for who I was, for whatever the pace. And that is ultimately over time, as that has built, as that has grown, has helped me to, it's like, I think of it like leveraging almost, like all the safety that I've experienced outwardly now, I can gather that and I can say, okay, can I just show you it's safe? And so when we go back to this phrase of being with, a lot of that is modeled after the experiences where someone was with me, where God was with me. I mean, truly, you know, that there were some of those really sacred spaces of taking some safe people. And I'll be honest, there wasn't a lot. There wasn't a lot. It wasn't about a lot. But as my body began to believe that it was possible, my system wasn't so locked up. My system wasn't quite so defensive and so unwilling to see that. So that being with, I really think of it as there's like a mutuality that is connected to it, right? Like it's hard to be with ourselves if we've never had experiences of anyone ever or very rarely being with us. And so there's really a spectrum. Like if that's, you know, for folks who are listening, if there are just so very little there, oftentimes that's really a lot of times even the first step is just like, is there someone who feels like I could take even the smallest risk to begin to be with in that way?
The first point that you make in your book and a point that you return to over and over is that in order to try softer, I have to be aware of what I'm feeling in my body. And as you said earlier, the prefrontal cortex, which is the part of your brain right behind your forehead, it's a part of the brain that has to be online and working for me to be aware of what I'm feeling in my body. So before I can try softer, before I can respond to, for example, my anxiety with compassionate curiosity, my prefrontal cortex has to be functioning. It has to be online. Here's the problem with that. When we experience distress to a significant enough degree, our prefrontal cortex shuts down so that we can focus all our energy on the perceived danger. So, Aundi, what am I supposed to do when I get so dysregulated, when I leave my window of tolerance and my prefrontal cortex shuts down? How do I get it back online so that I can be compassionate and curious about what's happening inside of me?
Great question. And I think this is a very real challenge. The further we are outside of our window of tolerance, the less likely we are to be able to have really any reflection.
Yes.
Or any capacity to influence.
Or even to notice.
Or even to notice at all. Like, again, there are times when, like, if you are in a life and death situation and your body is just going on what feels like essentially autopilot, it's because your body is perceiving that that really is the only way. And there's not anything, especially in that kind of a situation, that you would necessarily can do about it, because your body is essentially saying, this is life or death. We're going to get this. We're going to survive whatever way we know how. But let's just say, let's take like a step or two down from that. Let's say you're pretty dysregulated. You did something you didn't mean to do. And now you're noticing that you did that. So it's already that threat, you know, you're way past the threshold, but now you're beginning to notice. There's a couple things I would say. And one is like, I love using grounding. I love the practice of grounding, because what we're doing is essentially we're using our five senses to come back into the present moment, which, God willing, is actually safe.
Mm-hmm. And explain what you mean by grounding.
Yes. Yep. So grounding is when we are really, it's a form of mindfulness. With grounding, like you could go and you could go to each of your senses. And there's lots of ways to do grounding. Like you could notice five things you could see and four things you could touch. By focusing on these sensory things, this is actually helping to bring us back into the present moment. If you didn't even want to go that far, like honestly, if you're really dysregulated, I really recommend to folks to go outside, take your shoes off, and get your feet in the grass. Notice the texture, the sensation. What are you hearing? Pick up a rock. Notice the weight in your hands. Now, as I'm describing these things, depending on, you know, your orientation, that might sound a little funny. But basically what we're doing is when our bodies are really dysregulated, it's a way of almost leaving ourselves.
Yes.
Like again, we use that language of being with ourselves. So when we get that dysregulated, we're no longer with ourselves. So what we're doing in practices like that is we're returning. We're coming back. The more dysregulated you are, the longer it may take.
Yes.
And that's okay.
It's not only okay, it's the only way it can be. This is not something that you have cortical control over. What you're doing is you're responding to your awareness of your bodily state of dysregulation in the ways that you have access to in that moment. And for me, sometimes it takes hours before I'm even aware of how dysregulated I am. Sometimes it takes 10 minutes, but sometimes it takes hours and or days. What you're inviting people to in Try Softer is once you're aware that you're dysregulated, how about responding to your dysregulation with kindness and compassion? And as you put it earlier, with stewarding the love of God for your precious heart and body. That's what I hear you inviting us to. Once we're aware that we're dysregulated. And for many people, you know, they could put on their refrigerator a list of those grounding exercises you gave. The issue is not, I don't know what to do. The issue is, I don't want to be kind to myself when I'm dysregulated.
I just want to validate that because some of these things sound so simple that it almost can feel insulting. And I hope that folks don't hear that. But this is why in my own therapeutic work, it's so experiential. Like oftentimes I'm like, no, I get it, but let's do it together and let's just see. Would you be willing just to take a chance? Because when you've got the embodied experience of going from profound dysregulation to like, oh, I'm still a little dysregulated, but less. And truly, every time we return to safety from a neural pathway perspective, we're strengthening. We're strengthening the neural pathways that bring us back to, you know, the window of tolerance or the ventral vagal. And in doing that, every time it gets easier. And every time our body will believe us a little more. Our body will say, oh, that's not just nonsense. That's like a legitimate way to respond when we're really dysregulated.
Yes.
This is why I talk about with such profound respect why it matters that we recognize the cost of trauma, that we validate that responding to threatening situations by going out of our window of tolerance and having whatever trauma response is completely normal. It's normal to respond that way to threat. Your nervous system is responding accurately and appropriately. Mm-hmm. And so in a way, what we're doing for our body is we're helping our body begin to tell the difference between past and present.
Yes.
We're saying, hey, this happened and it was real and it was not okay. And I'm so proud of you. You did such a good job. You did exactly what you were supposed to. I'm so proud of you. And I just would like to show you why this present moment is different. Like, this moment is actually safe. Look, here's the grass. Do you see? Like, it's okay. Do you see this? Do you see the sun? Do you feel that rock? Look around. Do you see the threat? And as we do that, our body begins to go, oh, it is in the past. It didn't feel like it was in the past, which is okay. We're in process, but now I see.
It's so practical, grounding, responding to our dysregulation is so down to earth and practical. And yet it can be such a war zone for those of us with trauma. When we are dysregulated, when we've lost it with one of our kids, to respond to our stress hormones, our all the cortisol in our bodies with kindness can be an absolute war inside. But that's what you're inviting us to with that very disarming title, Try Softer. And there's something about the title, Aundi, that reminds me of the kingdom of God, because it's such a reversal of the American way of trying harder.
It is very countercultural. Yeah. And I feel like that's what's been interesting the last couple years. As you know, when this book released, it was about 2 months before the pandemic hit. And then it was like, all of us are being, like, everyone, even if you're not a trauma survivor, to some extent, in some way, you've been at least influenced by trauma. People got to this place where they were like, oh my gosh, I cannot try harder anymore. And that resonance of like, is there any other way?
Aundi, thank you so much for coming on the podcast and sharing not just your expertise as a therapist, but really your hard-earned personal experience with your own trauma story and how you have come to try softer.
Thank you so much. And thank you for just your compassionate witness today. It really, really was a good time together.